You are right that in this area, as other people see opportunity, and sometimes they can make promises that they are not really able to deliver, but they're just taking advantage of people's vulnerability. So the short answer is, for governments to avoid that risk, they must deal with that vulnerability. And the way to deal with that vulnerability is to make sure that the current dispensation delivers to the expectations of those communities. It is because these communities have seen governments receive revenue, they've not felt the impact, that when another person comes and says, I am going to do better, they become vulnerable. The only way is to make sure that the governments deliver to the expectations, improve the livelihoods of those people, make them party to the conversation, make sure they understand what the issues are. If they don't understand, if they don't see the benefits, then anybody who comes looks like, this is the one who's going to save me. Yes.
One last question. From your experience or knowledge, was there anything like, let's say, a natural resource is found in certain localities of a country, and that region specifically or locality claims to have a certain percentage share or kind of from the natural resource?
Yes, there are incidences, not just in Africa, where either because of the law of those countries, the law says while the minerals are vested in the state, the people in the area in which the minerals are found will have a certain right. And these rights vary. Sometimes they are limited to the mineral resource, sometimes they include the mineral resource, the land, and sometimes they are limited to the land. In most countries, the rights of the community are limited to the land, which is to say they lease the land on which the mining takes place, and they generate revenue from the rental that they get for the land. This is the most common. But there are certain areas on the continent. The one that comes to mind is in South Africa. In South Africa, on the northern part, is a tribe called the Bafokeng. The Bafokeng tribe, the mineral rights are vested in the tribe. And the tribe is the one that negotiates and enters into agreement with mining companies. And the proceeds go to the tribe. So there are areas in the continent where, yes, the tribe are the sole owners of the minerals, and they are the ones that grant the mining license, the lease. They are the ones that receive the rental. They are the ones that also receive any other benefits that derive from the operations of the mine.
Thank you. I forgot to mention one last question, which I think very important in terms of how to manage the environmental impact of this mining industry in general, because the local community are the ones who suffer at the end of the day. So was there any standard that you come across, or is there any advice that you say how it should be dealt in terms of avoiding environmental pollution, which impacts their lives?
So I'm not able to give advice, but I can give examples of best practice. So I think we should accept that mining, agriculture, oil development, industry, and for that matter, the development of cities affects the environment. I think this is an expected fact. The real question is, in affecting the environment, what do we know about the impact of each one of those activities? And to the extent that they are negative, how can we mitigate? In terms of mining, there are several effects, one of which is dust pollution, the other is the carbon footprint because of the enormous use of energy and the emissions from there. And they are now fairly standardized procedures. One, which is before you mine, you do a thorough study and an understanding of the impact, not just on the physical environment, but also the communities and how you disrupt them. You engage the community and you agree on how to mitigate those. But then, of course, the other is what happens after you leave. One of the accepted ways of mitigating the risk is that from the moment the mining company starts to operate, they open a trust fund in which they deposit enough money, and that every year this trust fund is audited to make sure the funds in the trust fund are enough to do whatever is necessary to restore the environment to its original form. So these are some of the ways in which the mining sector and others are trying not only to take responsibility, but to ensure that at the end of the life of mine, there is enough resources to be able to restore. And another is that it's one thing to restore the physical environment. It's another to restore the socio-economic. When the mine moves away, a huge question is, what's going to happen to the people that have been depending on this? So that's another vehicle. Mining companies and those who extract now have put measures in place wherein before the end of mine they start to develop alternative livelihoods. Some use tourism, some turn them into resorts, some turn them into completely new industries. But the industry now is not waiting until that last day. They work with the municipal environment and say, we have so many people. What are the other industries that, as mining and its activity diminishes, can replace mining? These are some of the ways of mitigating both the physical and the social environment.
Any last word that you would like to say to our audience? From your expertise?
Well, only that it's better if we work together.